So how do we secure our homeland and stay true to our values? We do it with four levels of collective response. It starts with the American people. From there, it extends to local law enforcement, and from there up to the federal government, and then finally out beyond our shores, where America's international allies can serve and do serve as partners in a collective fight against terrorism. In the last 4 weeks alone, I have traveled nearly 30,000 miles from Islamabad to Seattle, engaging partners in all of these levels. We have brokered international agreements, launched new partnerships, and challenged our citizens to play their part in our collective security. We face a common threat. It requires a collective response. And we must face that threat and coordinate that response in an evolving and highly networked world. So the network world takes on many forms. The cyber network that runs our power grids, fires our critical infrastructure, and facilitates commerce is now a target and is itself vulnerable to attack. This network climate forces us to rethink how best to protect our values and our security in a world where the tools for creating violence and chaos are as easy to find as the tools for buying music online or restocking an inventory. We also live in a mobile world with complex networks of people and information. We cannot forget that the 9/11 attackers conceived of their plans in the Philippines, planned in Malaysia and Germany, recruited from Yemen and Saudi Arabia, trained in Pakistan and Afghanistan, and carried them out in the United States. So that's why our Homeland Security network must be built to leverage force multipliers. We need new thinking. When we add a prominent former computer hacker to our Homeland Security Advisory Council, as I just did, it helps us understand our own weaknesses that could be exploited by our adversaries. And the threats we face are, by their very nature, asymmetrical. Terrorism more often has become privatized violence. It does not rely on links to an army or to a sovereign state. We often hear that this is what our globalized era looks like, but what is most salient about today's environment is that it is also networked, and in a networked world, information, true and false, moves everywhere all the time. And in that networked world, everyone who is part of the network, meaning all of us, can enjoy the tremendous benefits, but also must be ready and willing to learn about and help address the vulnerabilities that come with these benefits. So the team we put on the field needs to be bigger, better networked, and better trained. Our physical United States border should be our last line of defense, not our first. So together with the Department of Justice, we have now forged agreements to prevent and combat serious crime with 13 international partners. There's more to do on this front. Now, I want to give you a window into how important these partnerships are. Let me show you one example of our new approach and new thinking. Our growing relationship with Mexico is, of course, part of a broader effort, and it is designed to interdict not only the smuggling of narcotics, weapons, bulk cash, and people at the United States-Mexico border, but also designed to recognize our strong national, our homeland interests in the United States and Mexico and its relationship, and the whole national interest we have in making sure that Mexico and the crime there and the large cartels there are broken up. This direct, interactive approach with our international partners is a new approach, which we think is critical to dealing with things like cartel violence, and also helps us ensure that that violence does not spill across our border or weaken Mexico's ability to be a strong partner with the United States. So we're going well beyond what we've done in the past.
Terrorism can emanate from all kinds of places around the world, and that intelligence is very important. The number of possible threats is infinite. So how do you zero in on the most important ones? And yet, the resistance of people, let's say, at the CIA to share with the FBI and vice versa is legendary. How are you doing getting them to share with you when they have a tough time sharing with each other?
Let's talk about that, because there has been a legacy of non-sharing in some respects, which is a luxury we can no longer afford. And that is why we have a director of national intelligence. In fact, our group, which of the principals, which means the head of the FBI, the head of CIA, myself, Admiral Blair, we will be meeting tomorrow. We regularly have luncheons, just ourselves, no staff, to make sure that we are effectively communicating the sharing of information. I think the fact that I, as Secretary of Homeland Security, receive a daily intel brief, not just from members of the Department of Homeland Security, but also, for example, from a CIA briefer, helps ensure that critical intelligence is being shared. And in this administration, we're very intent on exercising how we handle intel and how we respond. Indeed, right now, there's a national-level exercise underway that will test some of this sharing capacity, whether things are being shared and whether responses are being correctly calibrated. So personal interaction, de facto interaction on a daily basis, and then exercising, I think, are the three major techniques to improve that intelligence sharing environment.